So good evening to one and all who have logged into this webinar. On behalf of Sri Ramakrishna Hospital, I welcome all of you. And today's speaker, Dr. Chelian, a renowned nephrologist in this region. And he has selected a topic of interest to all doctors, including family physicians, living well with chronic kidney disease, the role of family physicians. So this topic he has selected for the benefit of all the medical practitioners and for the benefit of ultimately to the patients. And Dr. Chelian needs no introduction. He is a well-known nephrologist in this region and with a tremendous knowledge of nephrology and teaching capability. Actually, he should have been in a medical college so that, I mean, students would have got benefited. Such a teacher he is. And I welcome all the consultants from this hospital and doctors from this hospital and other consultants from outside the Ramakrishna Hospital and family physicians from all over Coimbatore. And the office bearers of IMA and IMA doctors for joining this webinar. I once again welcome all of you on behalf of Sri Ramakrishna Hospital. And I welcome Dr. Chelian to take over. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Today we are going to have a discussion on an interesting topic, that is living well with chronic kidney disease. What is the role of family physician? So, in fact, this is probably the longest topic I have selected for any of my lecture. The idea of choosing this particular topic is because all of you know we celebrated the World Kidney Day on 11th of this month. Every year it is being celebrated all over the world on the second Thursday in the month of March. The theme for this year is living well with kidney disease. Now, what do you mean by this? Kidney disease is a prolonged disease. We all know chronic kidney disease is not curable. And generally, it is a progressive. That means somebody who comes with a creatinine of, say, 2.5 cannot expect to live in the same creatinine for another 5-10 years. Slowly, it will go up. Generally, it's a progressive disease. And finally, it can lead on to dialysis, that is at the stage where they may not be able to live without a supportive measure. They need dialysis. The dialysis is very expensive. Once it started, it goes lifelong. It puts burden on the family, not only on the financial side. Somebody has to spare time to bring them for the unit and take them back. And in between any emergency, breathing difficulty, they have to run here and there. So the patient, very often they need the support of the family. And even though it's a simple procedure, but not very comfortable. Patient has to get a needle prick, some BP drop, some cramps, some tiredness. So it's not a very comfortable one. So that is another problem with dialysis. Okay, the better option for them will be a kidney transplant, but it is much more expensive. But more than that, it is very difficult to find a matched live donor. So many often with a short family, small family, like one child, two children. So you may not have a person to donate for you. So that is a problem. Even if they like to donate, there may be some problem. Even though we have started doing ABO incompatible kidney transplant, still a matched donor may not be available. Other option for them will be to register for a cadaver kidney transplant, but which has got a very long waiting period. So many patients are already waiting. In fact, 2 days back we did a cadaver transplant after a gap of 1 year because we have to stop it due to COVID. But this lady has been on the waiting list for almost 5 years. So only now she got a kidney allotted to her. So a very long waiting period. So these are all the things already we medical people very well know. And most of the time we would have told our patients about this probability of them once they develop chronic kidney disease. And many of them they Google to they get little more extra knowledge than us. Now, You say you live well with chronic kidney disease. Now, what do you mean by that? Many of the time, once you say you have got a chronic kidney disease, the patient gets a fear. Many patients, they will tell me, sir, if there is a heart problem or a brain problem, it's okay, sir, I am having kidney problem. So they have some fear on about the kidney disease. Second, whether they can carry out their routine life, that is their main concern. So like the routine family life, routine, whether they can go for their job. Some of the jobs involve a lot of tension, some irregular timing of food. They have to travel 2-3 days to the outstation, where they may not get a very strict diet, so they have to they may not be able to be maintain a strict diet control. Physical activities, sometimes because of the anemia or hypertension, those who have to do a manual work for some 6-8 hours, they find it little difficult once they get a chronic kidney disease. Other, apart from, even before going to dialysis itself, it's quite expensive. They have to go for a regular follow-up to the doctor. Invariably, you have to do certain investigations very regularly. Even at the minimum category, you have to do on urea, creatinine, on potassium. Some just has to be done regularly. And the drugs are a little expensive. So many drugs has to be given for control of hypertension. They may not be controlled with just one drug or two drugs. So there is a problem. The moment somebody is declared, said they are having a chronic kidney disease, a lot of problem in a marital relations, especially those who are married within 2 years or 3 years. Majority of the marriage, they breaks at the time, adding stress and psychological stress to the family. And if it is a female, the question asked by both by the patient as well as by her husband is whether she can conceive. So because most of the time, pregnancy, we want them to avoid. So all these problems will come to the patient. So with that, how to live well? So that is a question. So the thing is, these are all the real genuine problem of the patient, but still it is not the end of the road for a patient with chronic kidney disease. So first thing is they have to be consoled and they have to be told that this is like something like diabetic and hypertension, where the disease may not go, but still you can have a fairly decent life for a very long time. Some of my patients on conservative measures for almost 15-20 years without entering into dialysis, of course with a lot of strict diet restrictions and a lot of medication and checkup. So we have to guide them how to do go about. At the same time, there are a lot of methods can be taken up by a family physician, which will help the patient to live a long time with chronic kidney disease before entering into dialysis or going for transplantation, can have a fairly long life and a fairly comfortable life. So what is the role of physician in helping the patient to have a fairly normal life? So first is, you have to diagnose early. Most of the time, the patient with chronic kidney disease, if they are diagnosed late, like with the serum granule, say 4, 5 and so on, we have got not much thing to do, so we can support them for some more years, but many of them, they end up in dialysis. Some of the patients are diagnosed with a lot of complications like pulmonary edema or seizures and found to have a very severe renal failure and has to be taken up for dialysis immediately. So diagnosing very early is very, very important. The family physician play a very important role in this aspect. Second, having made the diagnosis, counseling the patient, as I said earlier, the patient has got a lot of apprehension and doubt about their disease and worries. So this can be fairly, it can be counseled by the family physician. And third thing is, there are a lot of dietary restrictions and diet changes. So again, this has to be done by the physician. They have so many doubts which they may not find time to ask the nephrologist. We ask them to meet a dietitian, but many times they ask the family physician whether I can take this vegetable, that vegetable, how to boil it, what salt to buy, and so on. So definitely a physician play a big role in addressing the diet for the patient. Then of course, you have to treat the patient for a long time. So most of the time, patient diagnosed very early, they can be managed with physician itself. So we have to treat the patient. Basic guidelines I will give you. So with that, you can manage the patient for a few years before referring to a nephrologist. And you should also know when to refer to a specialist and also when they will need a dialysis, otherwise what you call as renal replacement therapy. So this is the role of family physician. I will touch upon all points so that it will help you to help your patient. So first we'll check, we'll just see that what do you mean by chronic kidney disease. Earlier we were using the term chronic renal failure. That is when the GFR falls below 60 ml, when the GFR falls below 60 ml per minute, we call this chronic renal failure. So renal failure means there is a elevated serum creatinine, so which indicates that this patient kidney is not functioning normally. But now we have replaced this term with a term called chronic kidney disease, where we have also included the other features of kidney damage. So other features of kidney damage lasting for more than 3 months, with or without decrease in GFR. GFR can be normal, still if the patient has got kidney damage, it's called chronic kidney disease. It can be shown as pathological or with the markers of kidney disease in blood or urine. In other words, suppose somebody has got only microalbuminuria or 1 plus proteinuria or 2 plus proteinuria, but with a normal creatinine, say 0.8, 0.9. So by old definition, it is not, a chronic, is not any chronic renal failure. But this, you call it as chronic kidney damage. Similarly, by imaging study, you find a patient having, say, autosomal or dominant polycystic kidney disease, multiple cysts in both kidneys. Even the, at the time of diagnosis, they have fairly normal urea creatinine, till they come under the category chronic kidney disease. Now, basically, chronic kidney disease, we divide them into 5 stages. The first stage is where you find only kidney damage with normal or even sometimes increased GFR. Classical example will be very early stages of diabetic nephropathy, where you may find the GFR more than 90 ml. This is called stage 1. Stage 2, the creatinine starts slowly going up. The GFR falls from 90 to 60. This is called stage 2. The stage 3 is fairly a moderate renal failure, where the GFR is from 30 to 59. Again, stage 3 is divided into stage 3A, that is 30 to 44. 45 to 59 GFR is called as stage 3B. Then, when the creatinine level is further increased, when the GFR is less than 30, we call it a stage 4. When it is stage 5, it is called as the end-stage renal disease. And by definition, in the end-stage renal disease, it means the patient can no longer survive without a renal replacement therapy. Renal replacement therapy means either dialysis or transplantation. So generally, we take them for dialysis when the GFR is less than 10 ml per minute. So the first role of physician is to diagnose early. So you must have a fairly high degree of suspicion to pick up a chronic kidney disease in early stages. As you know, almost 70 to 75% of patients with CKD, it is due to either because of diabetic or hypertension. So diabetic and hypertension patients, when they come to you for a regular checkup, at least once in a year, they have to do some basic investigation like urinary proteinuria. You look for proteinuria, you do urea creatinine. In some selected cases, probably even microalbumin helps you, especially in diabetic patients. So you have to diagnose early. So at least once in a year, you should have a general checkup. Because the renal disease has got very, very few symptoms, especially kidney-related symptoms. The symptoms what you might have will be a generalized edema, especially arterial edema. But again, the arterial edema is more often due to other causes like cardiac failure, cirrhosis, and so on, rather than renal failure. So edema may be one symptom. Patient may come out with a history of low urine output, like oliguria or anuria. But very often, a patient with chronic kidney disease, they have polyuria. They pass fairly good amount of urine and they do it in night time. Nocturia is another important early sign of chronic kidney disease. A patient with stone or infection might have dysuria or hematuria, maybe because of an infection, tumor, or more often it can be due to a glomerular disease. Some patients, intelligent patient, may even complain about a foamy urine. So these are the symptoms which are related to the kidney disease, but only very few patients, they have the problem, and the symptoms are also very less. It's not very alarming symptoms. So very often patients will be able to manage on their own. They come to you very late, unless you specifically ask for it. After that, the symptom of nocturia always give importance about the kidney disease. More often the patient says nocturia, they do on blood sugar, urine sugar. If it is normal, patient is happy. They don't even see the doctor. They say no diabetes. So, but whenever somebody says nocturia, also do urea and creatinine, because it is one of the early features of chronic kidney disease. And the main reason is the kidney is not able to concentrate the urine. The other important clue what a general physician can have about chronic kidney disease is the presence of blood pressure. So any patient, irrespective of their complaint, when they come to your clinic, you record your blood pressure. If it is going to be very frequent patients coming for some way complaints, but still, at least once in a month or once in 3 months, you must have recorded their blood pressure, irrespective of the age. Even a pediatric patient, better to record their blood pressure at least once, so that you may not miss a thing. Because the pressure, high blood pressure, hypertension, may be an early or probably the only clue for a renal disease. So evaluate this patient with a young and hypertension. You find this patient is having a renal parenchyma disease more often, having high urea creatinine or proteinuria, or they may have a rare disease like renal artery stenosis or autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. So all these things are picked up when you try to evaluate your hypertension. So all patients should have at least one recording of blood pressure, which might help you to diagnose these patients early. Then to make a diagnosis of kidney disease, we need certain investigation. One is a routine urine analysis. That is where you do a dipstick to look for various components. Of the two things important is, one is protein, other one is hematuria. Then under microscope, you look for RBCs, WBCs, RBC cast, WBC. These are all things which gives you a clue about a chronic kidney disease. You have to ask for a blood test, urea and creatinine. So both are elevated in patients with chronic kidney disease, right from stage 3 to 5. 1, 2, it may be normal. And if needed, we have to ask for one ultrasound or done. And proteinuria, generally it is done by dipstick. There just got a number of causes, we will see in the next slide. So any proteinuria more than 2 plus, you have to be very careful. You have to, they need detail, you go for a detailed history, and they may need evaluation. A 1 plus may be present in so many non-renal conditions, but still you cannot be ignored. You can ask the patient to repeat the urine after 3 months or 6 months and make sure that it disappears. But if it is persistent, you have to evaluate them. Usually dipstick is commonly used. If not available, can you go for heat coagulation or sulfosalicylic test. Once somebody has got a proteinuria of 2 plus or more, then you have to do a 24 hours urinary protein excretion. You collect urine for 24 hours and find out how much of protein is being leaked. But this test is little cumbersome. It may not find favor with the patient. Patient might have come from a faraway place. They want to go early with the report. So then in that case, you can go for what you call it as urine protein creatinine ratio. This is what we, most of us, we do in our office practice. Urine protein creatinine, that is, you send one spot urine sample. It can be done at any time, not necessarily in the morning hours, but this creatinine ratio is done in a spot urine, where they analyze what is the protein level in milligram per deciliter, then creatinine level in milligram per deciliter. You take a ratio, the ratio gives it 24 hours of protein excretion in grams. That is, suppose somebody's urine protein is 50 milligram per dl and creatinine also 50 milligram per dl, their TCR, protein creatinine ratio, is 1. So that means their 24 hours urinary excretion is 1 gram in a day. Suppose it is 50 milligram for protein and 100 milligram for creatinine, that means it's only 0.5. 0.5 may not be a pathological one. Suppose it is 100 milligram protein per deciliter and 150 milligram of creatinine per deciliter, it means it is 2 grams of protein excretion. So similarly, you can calculate. It's a very simple test available almost on all the labs. This is what about the proteinuria. Then normally you've got, you excrete less than 150 ml of protein in a day. Basically, mostly it is made up of TAMR salt with a very small amount of albumin, IgA, beta-2, microglobulin, light chain, and so on. There are some conditions where you may have a protein excretion or proteinuria without any renal disease. One is intense physical activity. Sometimes you ask the patient to do the test in the morning. They go for a very brisk walk or do a gym workout and then go to the lab and give the urine test. It may show a proteinuria. But if you repeat it after 3-4 days without much physical activity, then you will find it is going negative. So you must ask the history whether they did it, or at least tell them not to go for a morning walk on the day of test. So intense physical activity is one. Urinary tract infection, it is mainly because of the IgA secreted in the lower urinary tract. Totally uncontrolled diabetes mellitus will have proteinuria, which will disappear with just control of sugar itself. Very high blood pressure and avert heart failure. Acute febrile illness, irrespective of the cause, they all contain, and very low fluid consumption will produce a proteinuria, which will disappear once the primary problem is sorted out. In female patient, you should always ask for the menstrual history and if there is any history of vaginal discharge. That will also will confuse the issue. Another next finding is hematuria. Remember, even a small amount of blood leak, that is 5 ml in per liter of urine, will produce a very, very gross hematuria-like picture. Very often, hematuria is picked up by a dipstick, but it has to be confirmed with microscopy. Normal urine contains less than 1 to 2 RBCs per high power feed. But you have to avoid the first sample, because first sample, the RBCs might have lysed because of the overnight stay in the blood. Probably you have to ask them to do a, give a second or third sample for RBCs. Next, third is about renal failure. The term renal failure physiologically means a reduction in glomerular filtration rate. Biochemically, of course, it is manifested as a rise in blood urea and creatinine. Normally, we do both blood urea and creatinine. Both has got little different mechanism. Blood urea is basically produced by the liver. It is by the degradation of protein, either present in the diet or endogenous protein, like upper GI bleed and so on. Normally, the kidney filters urea very freely, but 50% of the urea is reabsorbed. Okay. For creatinine, it is basically produced by the muscle, freely filtered at the level of kidney. Very, very small amount is secreted. Practically, you can say neither absorbed nor secreted. And its value varies with the muscle mass, especially due to the age, sex, and other male will have more muscle mass. Again, the age of the patient also will count. But if you go of the two, probably the creatinine is a better one because the production is fairly constant because of the muscle. But the urea, the production is variable. If the liver function is not good, it may actually produce less. But if the individual takes a very high protein diet or if there is upper GI bleed, the protein urea level will vary. So of the two, the better one is serum creatinine. But it also has got its own problem, especially when you use creatinine alone as a marker for renal function. Sometimes you miss. The creatinine level will go above the normal limit only when it is less than 50%. So you may miss a yearly renal failure. So better to do both urea and creatinine. Again, next is what you call as creatinine clearance. Very often, more than serum creatinine level, we do what you call as creatinine clearance. This is a classical good old formula called Cockcroft-Gault formula, where the creatinine clearance is calculated by this. So by this example, for example, if you take two examples, one is serum creatinine is only 1.2. So the individual, you find, if he is a 20-year-old male with a 80 kilogram of body weight, you will find his GFR is coming as 92 ml. So 1.2 creatinine in a 20-year-old male, it indicates a fairly normal, good renal function, 92 ml per minute. But if the same 1.2 creatinine in a 70-year-old male who is weighing just 40 kg, so if he is weighing only just 40 kg, if you calculate the GFR, it comes to only 32 ml per minute. So same creatinine level, but you find that renal function is so different. It is almost, it is in stage 4. So it is such a severe renal failure, but here it is a donor. So if you go only by creatinine, very often you may be full. So better you go for what you call as creatinine clearance. And good old formula will be to collect 24 hours urine and do it, but not practically possible. So you got a lot of formula whereby you can calculate GFR, that is what we call it as eGFR. So most of the labs, when they ask for serum creatinine, below serum creatinine, they write one word called eGFR. What do you mean by eGFR is estimated GFR. This GFR is estimated by various different formulas. Probably the first one to come into the market was MDRT study equation, where they put up lot of inputs about the creatinine clearance, creatinine and patient's weight and that. So finally, they come into a conclusion where you know only the sex and age of the patient, you calculate the GFR just from serum creatinine. Of course, there are a lot of formula came later, modified MDRT formula. Now, more often we use CKD-EPA creatinine equation. Of course, in pediatric age group, this formula may not work, where they use another formula called Revesh-Schwartz formula. Now, what these formulas end up? eGFR, most of the lab, they themselves will calculate and give it in the report. So if it is less than 60, that indicates that individual is having renal failure. But if the lab has not given, you are a little confused, there is no problem. A lot of apps are available. So one useful app is what is given by the National Kidney Foundation. You can download it in your mobile, and the different formulas are there. Generally, we go for the CKD-EPA creatinine equation, and you can have other formula. So then, with that formula, you can put the, this is example I have shown with the Tatra trauma, where you enter the serum creatinine, you put the weight of the patient, age of the patient, and then you put whether it is a male or female, you get the value. This is the creatinine clearance. If you use the other formula, EPA, that there is no need to put the weight of the patient. Very often the lab may not know the weight of the patient. Even the age, sex, and creatinine level itself will give you what is the creatinine clearance. Any creatinine clearance below 60 indicates that individual's renal function is not good. You have to pay little extra attention and to have to treat it. Even though the creatinine appears reasonably normal, like 1.2, 1.4, and so on. This is a useful one from NKF, National Kidney Foundation. Now, few words about the CKD. There are two things. One is initiating factor for kidney disease. Why somebody gets a kidney disease, chronic kidney disease? One is, commonly we know, diabetes and hypertension. They account for almost 70-75% of the patient. Then some of the immunological injury, like a patient with systemic lupus erythematosus, patient with IgA nephropathy, patient with various glomerular disease. There is a immunologically vasculitis, and so on and so on. Immunologically, kidneys are attacked and they start the disease. That is the initiating factor. Some congenital anomalies like cystic disease, obstructed pulmonary junction obstruction, reflex nephropathy, and so on. Some genetic factors and plus some environmental factors. This environmental factor, of late, we are paying a lot of more attention. That is what we call it as CKD unknown. There is a one category called CKD unknown. Finally, we find out a lot of factors are implicated. One is their dietary habit, their habit of using a lot of native medicine, groundwater, a lot of contamination in the groundwater, fertilizers and other so many chemicals, insecticides that are used. So all these things, they cause cluster of chronic kidney disease in various places that we call it relatively called environmental factors. So these factors, we may not be able to play a very big role, but there are some factors which causes a progression of the chronic kidney disease. So these are this is the place where a family physician can do a good job, and thereby you try to prevent the progression or at least prevent the rate of progression of the chronic kidney disease. The first and foremost thing is the blood pressure. Higher the blood pressure in a CKD patient, it rapidly progresses to become a end-stage kidney disease. Then in a diabetic, very poor glycemic control, worsens the activity. Then activation of RAAs, we'll spend few slides on it. High dietary protein always will produce more glomerular injury and glomerular filtration, thereby it causes progression. Proteinuria will cause problem. Presence of smoking, like smoking causes coronary artery disease, it also causes chronic kidney disease. Hyperlipidemia itself can cause chronic kidney disease and presence of severe anemia. So these are the things where we can intervene. We can intervene, we can advise, we can give some treatment. Thereby you try to reduce the progression of the disease. Now, so once you made a diagnosis of chronic kidney disease, the points what I tell is all for the physician's level. So you make a diagnosis of chronic kidney disease. You find somebody's creatinine is 2.5 or 3. You ask for an ultrasound, shows bilateral chondroid kidney. So it indicates if this individual is having a chronic kidney disease. It doesn't mean it's the end of it. First, you look for any reversible cause, whether we can do something to reduce the creatinine from a diagnosed level, say from 4, whether we can bring it to 2.5 or 3 and so on. The level, how much you reduce, it definitely is going to help them in a long way. So look for reversible causes. Again, I will come to that a little later. That is the first and foremost thing and correct it. Second is, you find there is no reversible cause, then I want to reduce the rate of progression. Two things which plays a very important role. One is the control of blood pressure. Second is the dietary manipulation. So again, we'll have a few slides on it. And then if they develop complication, uremic complication, like say, for example, itching, breathlessness and so on, you try to detect, try to prevent, if not possible, at least treat. Give the patient a comfort. If they get uremic gastritis, dyspepsia, you treat it. If they are itching, you treat it. So that these all things can be done by a family physician. You give some comfort for the patient. And then whenever you write a drug for a patient with CKD, you have to be very careful. Again, I will give you some few tips how to go about writing the drugs for this patient. And of course, in a long run, they may need dialysis, or you have to prepare them. Some certain basic things physicians can play a role. Now, what are the reversible causes of renal failure? Probably the most common cause of reversible cause of renal failure is hypovolemia. Many times the patient with uremia, they have vomiting. And they will have, because of the vomiting, they will have hypovolemia. Because of their distaste, they may not be drinking much. And sometimes they present with edema and you start on diuretic, but which the patient continues. Our patients are very fond of taking drugs for months and years. Today, last two cases I saw in my OP was one fellow has come almost 7-8 years. At the time it was created was 2, now it has come with 8. Another person has come after 3 years. So they are happy with the drug what he has given, and they are continue to take, and they come back in a batch. So somebody takes diuretic without medical supervision, that itself can produce hypovolemia. So you give them, hydrate them well with either with water or even with some IV fluids. Their creatinine comes down. So that is the most important first common reversible factor. If they have very severe hypertension, control it immediately. That will also will cause improvement in the renal parameter. All infection will worsen the renal failure. So you control the infection, especially UTI will cause more severe renal failure. Control the infection, that's good. Then you have cardiac failure, control the failure, treat it. If they have obstruction, either it may be in the level of prostate or some stone or some pelvic aortic junction obstruction, you relieve the obstruction, again renal parameter improve. If they are on some drugs which are nephrotoxic, you withdraw the drug, their renal parameter will improve. So these are the things are reversible cause of renal failure, which you can do it. Next is treatment of hypertension. So when you treat hypertension in CKD, it is a little tough job because many often the patient need combination therapy. They may not be controlled with just one drug or maybe even two drugs. So the aim is to lower the blood pressure. Apart from lowering the blood pressure, you have to preserve the renal function. So maintain the GFR. And the main problem with CKD is many of them, they die of cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. So you have to look for and work up for that, and you have to prevent it. Now, these are the group of drugs commonly being used right from the olden days, diuretic, beta blocker, calcium channel, ACE inhibitor, ARB, then alpha blocker and so on. Of that, diuretic, once somebody with chronic kidney disease, thiazides may not be effective. Probably you have to go for loop diuretic, which may not be a very good antihypertensive, may be generally used as a supplement. Beta blocker generally given up as antihypertensive in most of the practice, but in patients with renal failure, it can be given. With especially severe renal failure, but of course you have to be careful with the modification of dose. Calcium channel blockers, especially non-dihydropyridine group, we use right and left because they are the most potent antihypertensive, like nifedipine. Nowadays we start using more of cilnidipine and benedipine with little extra dosage. Even the good old nifedipine and amlodipine is very good. So we can use for the control of blood pressure. But the most important class is AC inhibitor and ARB. Again, I will spend a few slides on it. I will complete later. These drugs like prazosine, clonidine, moxonidine, even hydralazine, they are all only as add-on therapy. Like when you are not able to control the blood pressure with the earlier 3-4 classes of drugs, probably you add these other things as add-on drugs. Some patient needs 5-6 or even 7 class of antihypertensive to control their blood pressure. Now, when you aim for the treatment, you go for the 140/90. If they have proteinuria, probably you have to even reduce it further. So the main drugs what we use in patients with early stages of CKD is mainly AC inhibitor and ARB. In the stage of microalbuminuria, when you use it, they are very useful, and sometimes they even reverse the disease. Macroalbuminuria, again, they reduce the proteinuria. But as the patient start having renal failure, the drugs, when you start using this AC inhibitor and ARB, you have to be more careful. So with the creatinine of less than 2.5, you can use it, but use it cautiously. Above 2.5, generally I will say family physician, don't try, because nephrologist we still use it because the problems are more. You have to be careful. Above 5, if the patient is only ready for dialysis, then you use this drug. Otherwise, you don't use this drug. Now, these are some of the dose which is recommended for the AC inhibitor. Commonly, we use ramipril. We use up to, we can go up to 20 milligram in early stages. Enalapril is still used in the government hospital. So these are the things. Little different. Peridopril is also quite often used. And here we also, we have got a lot of classes. We commonly use nowadays telmisartan and olmesartan. Of course, even ajinomersartans are being used. Telmisartan, you can go up to 80. The olmesartan, you go up to 40 milligram. Now coming to the dosage of the AC inhibitor and ARB. The dose, initial dose of AC inhibitor and ARB should be very low. That is, you start with the, for example, I want to use ramipril. Don't start with 10 milligrams. You start with 2.5, like 15 to 25% of the usual dose you start, then slowly you build up to 5 milligram, then you can go up to 10 milligram. The dose should be increased very slowly, and you look for the whether they are tolerating the drug. What do you mean by the toleration? The AC inhibitor and the ARBs, they act on the renin-angiotensin system. So basically they will reduce blood pressure, but similarly the effect is they reduce the GFR also. So invariably the creatinine level starts going up slightly, and then it will get stabilized. So a rising serum creatinine after starting AC inhibitor and ARB is well known. You should closely monitor. So when you, and similarly the hyperkalemia also is one of the most important common complication of AC inhibitors and ARB. So when you start the treatment, so you start with monitor the blood pressure, of course, that you would have done. Always ask for one serum creatinine and serum potassium before you prescribe anybody AC inhibitor or ARB. So after that, you have serially monitor them. Some patients rarely they develop allergic reaction. AC inhibitors, olden days, we used to have cough. Of course, if there is cough, you can replace it with ARB. You must avoid it during pregnancy, AC inhibitor and ARB. Now, how are you going to monitor? As I said earlier, creatinine is likely to go once you start AC inhibitor. In other words, somebody's serum creatinine is, say, 1.5. You start them on AC inhibitor or ARB. So you will find the creatinine will go up from 1.5, it goes to 1.7, 1.8 and so on. So it will go up, but after that it gets stabilized. So you have to serially monitor, at least initially within 7 to 14 days. If it remains same, 1.5 remains same, then probably next you check after 1 month. If it is okay, then once in 3 months should be okay. If it is going up, again recheck the value within another 10 to 14 days. A rise of 30% creatinine is accepted. For example, somebody's creatinine is starting range 1.5, you can allow it to go up to 2. So if it goes beyond 2, probably it is doing more harm for this patient. Or you have hyperkalemia, which cannot be managed with diet, probably this patient is not getting more problem with the AC inhibitor ARB than getting a benefit. So if it is so, you have to withdraw this AC inhibitor and ARB. Otherwise, you can continue. On a long run, you will find the kidney function gets very stabilized. Just initial rise, say from 1, you can allow it up to 1.8. One from 1.1, if it goes, don't stop that. You continue for some time. You monitor for 3 months. In 3 months, it has not crossed 30%. This patient will do better with the AC inhibitor and ARB. So that's why we say start with a very low dose and slowly you tighten it up. Whenever you increase the dose, you have to check the parameter more frequently. Next is the diet in chronic kidney disease. So what is the diet restriction we say for a chronic kidney disease? First is you have to restrict the salt. Normally a South Indian diet will have around 12 to 14 grams of salt. So you have to restrict them in the early stages to 6 grams, that is maybe 50% of the salt they have to take. But in the, with the, as the renal failure get worsened, you have to reduce it to even 4 grams per day. They have to avoid this so-called rock salt. So many patients, they take that Hindu food. So they are very fond of this drug, which contain, I mean, with salt, which contain very high potassium. So you tell them, avoid this rock salt. And by ordinary classical salt, you buy, you take up to 4 grams in a day. Fluid, generally, they are asked to take it very liberally. You have to take up to 2000 ml in a day, because many times the kidney is not able to concentrate. They have passed a lot of urine. So you have to give 2000 ml. Very few patients may have edema, so they have to reduce it. Or if they already have a low ejection fraction, cardiac failure, they have to restrict. Otherwise, you will say 2 liter. The diet should be low in potassium, low in purine, low in phosphate, and they have to take adequate calories, because otherwise there will be endogenously breakdown of protein to form calorie. That is a neoglucogenesis will happen. Again, that will also will worsen the renal parameter. So they have to take an adequate calorie. So what all things they have to avoid? They have to avoid green leaves, which is very rich in potassium and purine. That is a thing you have to avoid. They have to avoid all these grams, green gram, Bengal gram, and other thing you have to avoid. Are very much restrict, and nuts like groundnut, cashew nut, and other things they have to restrict. Juice, all juices will have very high potassium. They have to avoid juice. And tender coconut water, they have to avoid. Fruits, very few fruits like apple, guava, papaya, pineapple, pear, they may have less potassium. They can be allowed to take a little amount. But other fruits, they have to strictly avoid. All red meat, they have to avoid, but they can take fish and chicken, egg yolk to be avoided, egg white can be taken. And they have to restrict dal, and whenever they use certain vegetables and dal, they have to put it in hot water, leave it for 10-15 minutes, then leach it out, and then you cook it, so that the potassium content can be reduced. So we can allow certain fruits, most of the vegetables you can allow except green leaves, make sure that they leach the vegetables. Dal, they can take a reasonable amount. Of course, they have to leach the dal. They can take egg white, they can take chicken, fish. You can have some variety. So they need not get worried that they have to take only this much. Of course, the salt restriction is the one thing which really hurts the patient, and of course, that has to be strictly followed. Then, if they have anemia, commonly it is due to erythropoietin deficiency. Very often, Indian setting, it will be having iron deficiency and other B12 folic acid deficiency. You have to supplement them. If needed, they may require erythropoietin or darbepoetin. And most of the patients will have some acidotic feature. Many times we prescribe them on bicarbonate tablet, 500 to 1000 milligram up to TDS. But whenever you use bicarbonate, sodium bicarbonate, you have to calculate the sodium also, because it can produce edema, it can cause high blood pressure. You have to be careful whenever you use sodium bicarbonate tablet. Again, hyperkalemia is the life-threatening complication. They have to be very strict with their diet. And then hyperuricemia is another problem, which itself can cause worsening of renal parameter. So if the uric acid is above 8 mg per deciliter, we can use certain drugs like allopurinol with a lot of side effects, but newer drugs like levetiracetam are well tolerated when compared with allopurinol. Then they may have uremic symptoms like nausea, vomiting. It can be treated with ranitidine or proton pump inhibitor along with domperidone and rosuvastatin. If they have severe itching, check for the calcium and phosphorus. If it is there, you have to correct it. Use moisturizing cream and antihistamine. All brands can be used. Edema, if it is there, look for the serum protein. And apart from anemia, look into the serum protein level. There is a big category called renal osteodystrophy. It's a little big topic. Many times they have body pain, myalgia, and so on. It can be due to so many things. But basically, they all require either alpha calcidol or calcitriol. That is the activated vitamin D3, because kidney is converting one alpha polycalciferol into 125 dihydroxy polycalciferol. So you have to use an activated vitamin D3, and the phosphate level is very high in the blood, that it creates a lot of problems. So you use phosphate binder, either calcium carbonate and calcium acetate. They are quite cheap, but the calcium can create problem. Newer drugs like lanthanum, sevelamer, they are far superior to calcium carbonate, but quite expensive. Sevelamer, even a cheap brand, will cost almost 40-50 rupees every day. So unless the patient can afford, otherwise you can stick on to calcium carbonate. Whenever you prescribe a drug in chronic kidney disease, you first see whether this drug is cleared by the kidney. Many drugs, they are cleared by the kidney. For example, if you take aminoglycoside, like Zetamax, it is excreted by the kidney. So anybody with renal failure, it stays in the circulation for a long time. So that is the main problem with the drugs. Some of the drugs which in itself will cause worsening of the renal parameter. Classical example will be NSAIDs. You give NSAID, the GFR comes down. So because the GFR comes down, the creatinine will go up. So that is another problem. So whenever you use a drug, make sure that the drug does not reduce their GFR. Second, the drug, if it is cleared by the kidney, you should know how to handle this drug or how to use this drug. So in practice, you must avoid all NSAIDs, irrespective of the fact, even if the creatinine is only mildly elevated. Even the patient with creatinine 1.52, better avoid all NSAIDs. Even one or two doses itself can create problem. If you use it for long term, definitely it will create problem. But some patients, even with two doses, three doses, they get fairly severe renal failure when they are in early stages of chronic kidney disease. So avoid NSAIDs. Instead, you can go for paracetamol, you can use Tramadol. If you find they have cellulitis where you want some anti-inflammatory action, you can use trypsin, gamotrypsin combination. So this will help them to reduce the inflammatory response in that area rather than using NSAIDs. Aminoglycoside, with the availability of so many new drugs, especially after quinolones came into the market, earlier days we are left with very few choice. We are having only penicillin group, then cephalosporin group, and only aminoglycoside. But nowadays, with quinolones, imipenem, meropenem, and so many other drugs are available, you can easily choose another antibiotic. So better avoid, but if you have to use it, yes, you can use it with a little modification. Then, if you are going to order for a contrast CT, another thing which you may be doing it in your practice, So you have to make sure that your creatinine is checked before you send any patient for a contrast CT, whether it is a CT brain or CT abdomen or chest. Make sure that their creatinine and creatinine clearance is calculated before it. When you use a drug, in renal failure, probably you have to use it with a reduced dose. For example, I want to use gentamicin. Somebody's kidney function is lost 50%. So instead of using 80 milligram 8-hourly, probably I like to use 40 milligram 8-hourly. Yes, it's a good choice. But when you use 40 milligram 8-hourly, it takes a very long time before you get a reasonable peak level. So in that case, you may not get a real therapeutic effect. So probably you have to give a loading dose. Probably the first dose you give either a full dose. Sometimes even you have to give a little extra dose to reach the peak level. But a subsequent dose, either you reduce the dose of the drug or you increase the interval. So instead of giving 8-hourly, you give 12-hourly or even once in 24 hours. You increase the length and the interval, or you reduce the dose. That is for the maintenance. Very often you have to give a first dose has to be a loading dose, because otherwise you don't get a therapeutic effect, especially if you are going to use an antibiotic. So when you use this drug, you have to very closely, you have to watch the toxic effect of the drug. So you have to make sure that the patient, in spite of your reduction in the dosage, still the patient may get into problem. You watch closely for the toxic effect. At the same time, you also watch very closely for the therapeutic effect. You think, you use the formula, you do a calculation, you give, take the literature and read, and then give as per the guidance given there. Still, your patient may not behave in a same way. So sometimes you find the therapeutic effect is not there. Probably you have to step up the dose, or if you get a toxic effect, you have to reduce the dose or change the drug. So whenever you use a drug, especially if it is nephrotoxic, you have to be very, very careful. It's not nephrotoxic, but a drug which can cause other side effects, if it is renally excreted, you have to modify it. So you should also know what are the conditions where the patient might require a dialysis. A CKD patient, once they reach stage 5, say when the eGFR is less than 15, so you watch for these symptoms like pulmonary edema, metabolic acidosis. Even if it comes, first you can try diuretic. For example, somebody comes with pulmonary edema, need not be straight away to dialysis unit. First, you can try a high dose IV diuretic and give the usual cardiac drugs. If they respond, it's fine. If they don't respond, probably they will require dialysis. Similarly, somebody with the metabolic acidosis not corrected with your bicarbonate tablet or sometimes with bicarbonate infusion, a severe metabolic acidosis, especially with severe hyperkalemia associated with it. Generally, metabolic acidosis goes with hyperkalemia. Life-threatening hyperkalemia, like more than 7, the potassium, probably the patient needs a very urgent dialysis. If you pick up a pericardial drop in a patient with severe renal failure, it is an indication for dialysis. So thereafter, any drug, any supportive measure will not help this patient. If you leave him alone, he will develop a hemorrhagic pericardial effusion and may develop cardiac and tamponade and die. A severe GI disturbance, like continuous nausea, vomiting, not responding to all your drugs, it is an indication for dialysis. Unless you dialysis, their health will not improve. They will become very bad. Patient having features of uremic encephalopathy, like a flapping tremor, that is asphyxis, or convulsion, or even coma, due to high blood urea creatinine, it is an indication for dialysis. So if you pick up these symptoms, immediately send them to a center where you have dialysis facilities. So once you start them on dialysis, yes, the patient is left with two things. Either you go for regular dialysis, it can be a regular hemodialysis. Nowadays, it is more freely available. At least Coimbatore city itself has got almost 35-40 dialysis unit, almost all periphery, including Sathi, Mangalam, Metropolitan, Avinashi, Pollachi. Everywhere you have got few dialysis units are available, many in the government setup itself. So patient can continue their dialysis in their unit, in a standalone unit, where even though a nephrologist is not available, but still good dialysis centers are available. Other things, CAPD, especially with the availability of so many hemodialysis units, has very much reduced. Main problem with that is infection, but still it is a good choice for selected patients of end-stage renal disease. Of course, the best option for a patient will be a transplant. If they have a donor, better go for a live related transplant as early as possible. That gives them a fairly a near normal life after the transplant. That is the only cure which we can offer for a patient with chronic kidney disease. His creatinine comes back to below 1 only when they undergo a transplant. Or if not available, then you have to wait for cadaver kidney disease donor program where the waiting period is quite long. So physicians definitely can consult the patient, diagnose early, so that it is the probably the most important aspect or role of a physician. Then most of the patients in the early stages, you can manage on your own. Only thing is you have to be a little careful, and when you use acinetary ARB, keep in your mind that it is a potentially dangerous drug. Sometimes it can create problem. And then whenever you write a drug for a patient, you have to be careful when you prescribe for a patient with end-stage renal disease. Thank you.
Thank you, Jayan, for your excellent explanation. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Very clear presentation. Thank you. As thank usual.
You. Thank you, Dr. Jayan.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any questions? I'm very happy to answer.
Any other questions from the participants? Because the lecture was so clear that I think no one will have any doubts.
Yeah.
I guess. Mm-hmm. Because Dr. Chelian used to take lectures just like taking to kindergarten students.
It's a crystal clear presentation.
Yes.
And definitely there should not be any doubt for anyone.
Yes.
Excellent for family yes. physicians. Very good.
Yeah.
Really, thanks.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this program. Thanks for sharing the link. We benefited. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much.
Thank you very
much. And I thank all the participants. And first of all, I mean, I should thank Dr. Chelian for his excellent presentation. And we look forward to more such presentations from Dr. Chelian. Yes, for the benefit of all, yes. all doctors yes. and inside and outside the hospitals. Thank you so much, Dr. Chelian.
Thank you, sir.
I thank the marketing manager and his team, and the public relations manager and team for their excellent arrangements. Thank you so much. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.